best boxing podcast in the world.
Call the cops on me, on a mission to be champs since they let me free.
Prepare for combat, my adversaries crumble. Face it, I got a reputation for damage. Busters get ready to rumble. They lock me in a cell, have me trapped in a living hell. Though not guilty, I'm still in jail. Brother, I serve my time like a soldier. Maintain composure. My shadow boxing, the fight to the death. Busting boulders. Every boxer with a pair of gloves. Best give up love. Here's a man from the makings of a thug. A lethal weapon, mine sharp. And in my heart, there's a wish to shake the world with the flurry of my black fist. Now once a high school dropout.
What's going on, everybody? Another episode of Chiefs Eats Box Show. As we're here with my boy JP. JP, what's up, man?
It's time, ladies and gentlemen. Apologies.
Yeah, we've been coming late the last couple weeks, but that's all right. First things first, let's do it like this. Follow us on Twitter at Chiefs Eats Box, iTunes, rate, review, being an unofficial sponsor. Subscribe on all the platforms. YouTube. Shit, I got put back. I didn't even put last week's on YouTube. That's pretty terrible. Spotify, all that good shit. JP, last week, Mikey Garcia gets the unanimous decision over Jesse Vargas. What'd you see, man?
He looked calm. He looked good. He kept catching Vargas with that 1-2 after a while. You figure him out. Outside of that, what I saw was somebody who's growing into a new body. Because looking at him, I'm like, you're a little bit bulkier than you once were. And I'm seeing somebody who's trying to, because I remember he said, I'm going to go there and I'm going to stay. And I was like, maybe. So in the next maybe year and a half, maybe even two, he going to wind up being built for that weight class. And he's going to hurt somebody. You know, his timing is still what it is. His intellect is, of course, what it is. He's a great fighter. It's just in my opinion. He's a great fighter. He has some weaknesses. Everybody has weaknesses. Mm-hmm. But what I saw was a guy who's feeling his way into a new situation. And he's doing damn good at it. And he's going to make a few waves. Like, it's certain people that's going to give him trouble, but the vast majority of people won't. And y'all got to remember something. Y'all remember how easily he beat Broner?
Mm-hmm.
Broner's basically a 147 fighter, even when he was 35 and
40.
Yeah. Like, so it's not like, just because he lost to Spence, it's not like he hasn't beat somebody that's been in that weight class. You get what I'm saying? So y'all got to take into consideration, he's kind of, His feet ain't just wet. He 10 toes down at this particular point. But he's going to get better. I know Vargas, he just fought a better fighter. Because he started out smoking. Vargas started out smoking. Like, okay, this might be a problem. And then Mikey kind of figured it out and is like, okay, I got you. Once he hurt him, that just changed the whole fight.
Mm-hmm.
That just changed the whole fight because now it's like, I think I smell blood in the water and I'm going to keep on him until, you know, and not let him catch a breather. So it was great. I mean, salute to both of them. Great fight.
It's like this for me. Everybody knows that I fucking mark out for Mikey anyway. That's kind of my thing on Twitter to do. But the truth is he's just one of those guys who starts slow. Like, even though, like, people were saying he lost first four rounds. I didn't see him lose the first four rounds. I saw him lose a couple rounds in the beginning and a couple of rounds that were competitive. And then he just started to figure him out, like you said. Around round four, he started to really figure it out. Five, he got the knockdown. And then he just kept a foot on the gas for a while up till round basically 11. He won all them rounds in a row and kind of took his foot off the pedal. And so, you know, Vargas won a couple late rounds there, but, it was close. It wasn't really close. The fight was never in doubt. Once the knockout happened, it was never in doubt. And Mikey's one of them guys, like, he kind of does, I'm not going to say he's the technician like Floyd was or that Crawford is, but he has that in him where it takes him a few rounds to figure it out. He's calculating shit in his head, and then he starts putting out his game plan. He's a counter puncher in every way. He's a counter puncher as far as your game plan. not just in the ring, but like he's gonna whatever you throw at him, he's gonna figure it out and then figure the game plan out and what to do after that. And that's what he does. That's what he did. The fight was never in doubt. It wasn't close. He clearly won. A lot of people unimpressed because like, well, yeah, but what would happen with this fight or that fight? Like, truth be told, we already know he can't beat Spence. Right? I don't give a fuck if you say you want a rematch. He can't beat Spence. We saw that he got dominated. He's not gonna beat Crawford, in my opinion. You know, everybody other than that, he can be competitive with anybody and beat a lot of them. That's just the truth about it. So going forward, look, he's been wanting that big fight, and it looks like he's gonna get that Manny fight, right? That's what it's looking like. We'll see. We'll see how long it takes him to announce it. But Mikey's the kind of guy, he'll wait for it. And I'll tell you right now, if he fucking gets in that ring with Manny and he beats Manny, I will be insufferable on Twitter. People are going to have to mute me. People who like me will have to mute me because I'm not going to let that shit go. All right. Look, this is another thing, right? Say like Danny Garcia, right? They still consider him, for whatever reason, one of the better fighters at 147, right? You take this win against Vargas, right? It's better than any win that Danny has at 147. It just is. I mean, who are you gonna put on there that's a better win? His Guerrero, the shell of Guerrero. There's who, right? Like
you got a point.
Granados, like, come on now, like. So let's put this shit in perspective. And I think that's what people aren't doing. They're not putting in perspective, like, where it sits. You know, like you said, the Broner fight. Even the Lipinets fight. Yes, it was at 140. Knocked him down. Let me tell you something. People can say whatever about the power or whatever. They don't think he... Like, who finishes Vargas, right? He didn't finish Vargas. Who fucking finishes Vargas? He was in the ring with Pacquiao. Pacquiao didn't finish him. So, I mean, let's not hold Mikey to a higher standard. So, you're holding Mikey to a higher standard than you hold Manny Pacquiao. That's basically what you're telling us. See, I want consistency when people start saying this shit, right? He knocked down. He knocks everybody down. Since Mikey's been on the scene, right? Not saying, like, let's go back to his early fights. Since Mikey's been on the scene in championship-level competition, how many people have not tasted canvas against Mikey?
Maybe one or two.
I'm going to give it to you. Broner?
And Spence,
that's it. Everybody else has been put on their ass. It doesn't matter who it is. They've all been put on their ass. That includes Lipinets. That includes Vargas. That includes Salido and Martinez and everybody else. Yeah, I mean, everybody. Like, so that's what he does, right? It's his timing. It's his straight punching, man, because straight punching is a foil for everybody. Everybody's a sucker for a straight punch. I don't know why, but they are. Like, what's the one punch that could really always cop Floyd that ever stunned him? It was always a straight. It was either a straight right or straight left. It always was that straight punch. He's got that. So, look, he can be competitive with Manny. Of course I'm going to pick him against Manny because that's what I do. I think he could beat Danny Garcia. Sean Porter, Sean Porter is a little too fucking big for him. Yeah. He's probably gonna be too much for him. That's just my opinion. So there's three guys at 147 that I think he probably isn't gonna beat. The rest of them, yeah, he could beat them. Now, could he lose to them? Sure, but he gets. I'll put him in there with anybody from 4 through 10 in the welterweight division, and he can beat them. He can beat them. I'm not saying he will. I'm saying he can. So I think people are just holding him to a different standard, a higher standard. He did his thing. He did what he was supposed to do. He took his time. He figured it out. He dominated and then took his foot off the gas. It kind of I talked about this earlier in the week. It kind of reminded me of Keith Thurman, Danny Garcia, where it was competitive for 2 or 3 rounds, and then Keith just took off, and it was over, and he ran the table for like 7 rounds in a row. Takes his foot off the gas, and everybody's saying, oh, it's a close fight. No, it wasn't. Don't mistake it for being a close fight. It was it was competitive at times, but it was they can fight 10 times. He's going to win all 10 times. That's just the way it is.
It's Like, when I think about it, like, even with him fighting Manny, that'll be an interesting fight just because of the timing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the time, like, as long as he can withstand the attacks, and Manny doesn't attack as much as he used to. So, the, even though, my opinion, he's still the best fighter in the business, but he doesn't, he's not, he doesn't jump on you like he used to. Which maybe you think he's slowed down. No, I don't think so. I just think he's kind of older and wise and like, I don't need to be extra right now.
Mm-hmm.
So, but because of that, if he doesn't put a beating on Mikey and he doesn't wear him down, his timing is still going to be there. So it always makes it an interesting fight because Manny's a person who can be dropped. It's not, it's rare,
mm-hmm.
but it's definitely possible. But... like, that'd be an interesting fight. Like, Porter, that's a problem.
Yeah.
Porter's a problem for Manny and Mikey. Just that whole style is a problem. It's a
problem for anybody in 147. Yeah. Who's had a convincing win versus Sean Porter? Nobody.
Yeah. Yeah, that's just a whole nother thing. Like, that's a whole nother animal. You know, the only person I could say in this whole mix that if the Manny fight can't go down with would be Thurman. Because that could be an interesting fight. Because Crawford might not happen. It could not. You know, depends. And I don't think, yeah, Crawford, that's a whole nother can of worms. But speaking on the Mikey part, there's not many people that could beat him. There's not many people that have the tools to beat him. There's not many people who are smart enough to beat him. So the fact that he's in that quote-unquote, we would consider like a money division,
mm-hmm.
which is not, you know, we're getting at the tail end of it being a money division because they're starting to thin the herd. So if he's coming along in this mix, this is a great jump start. Great jump start. And you can't get mad at Vargas for losing. You can't get mad at Mikey for winning because they're both good ass fighters. Let's not act like Vargas is a bum. And Mikey is supposed to be Superman. We're talking about high level people here, and if you want to be serious about boxing, in the last 10, 15 years, how often is it that two high level fighters, one just runs through the other? We could still talk about the people who do it because it happens so rarely.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you got to think about that. Like when we talk about knockouts and finishes, it's like. We still talk about Crawford and Gamboa because of the level that they were at back then. But that's what I mean. You got to go back that far to figure it out. You know, it may happen once every year or once every 2 years. So if somebody gets their ass whipped convincingly by another great fighter, that's all that is. I guarantee you this. Line up somebody else to think they're going to beat Jesse Vargas like that. See what happens. It's not going to go so well. It's just not.
He just doesn't. I mean, and look, and I don't think Jesse Vargas is a world beater at 147. Like his record was 3-2-1 going into that. It's 3-3-1. His three losses: Manny, Bradley, and Mikey. So I mean, that's what it is. I just think people, for whatever reason, people have really don't like Mikey. And honestly, I think it's ever since he left fucking Bob. For whatever reason, you leave Bob and people hate you. There was a lot of reason. That was some of the reason people hated Floyd for a while, was his Bob beef and everything like that. And you know, the style change definitely had something to do with it, but like he lives his career the way that everybody talks about. I'm a boss, I do what I want, I go where I want, I'm a free agent. No, honestly, Mikey's the only one who's actually lived that lifestyle of being a free agent, where he goes and he'll fight with PBC for a while. He's like, oh, I got a one off with the Zone. Now the Zone may ink him up again to fight Manny. Like, this Mikey has just lived his career out the way he wanted to, and I think for whatever reason that really pisses people off. We know Mikey has said this is not his first love, people. Boxing is not his first love, and he treats it very businesslike, and I think that rubs people the wrong way, you know. But the one thing is you can never say that Mikey's never been honest with what it is. He doesn't try to pretend like, oh, this is my love, and then treat it like, oh, it's such a business thing. He's always told you, this isn't my first love. You know, I do it as a way of a means to an end, financial gain. That's why he's at 147. What would you rather do? Fight Josh Taylor or Regis Progre at 140 or fight Manny Pacquiao at 147 or shoot for that, an Errol Spence fight on pay-per-view. He knows what he's doing. He got to pay a lot of fucking money for this Jesse Vargas fight. So,
yeah. Like, this is a lot of times athletes in general. When athletes become more cold as far as business savvy, people have an issue with that. I want you to just be an athlete. I just want you to do what entertain me. Why are you so concerned about money? No, because, you know, Floyd said it best. This prize fighting dummy. Like, I'm kind of glad that it's not his first love. Because when you look back at it, a lot of people who gave their life to a sport, when it's all said and done, the sport don't love them back. So I don't mind people milking it. You know what I'm saying? I don't. Because there are fighters out here who are hurt. You know, they're damaged. Y'all don't care. Y'all don't care. Don't act like if you see somebody who's punchy and all that, you care. No, you cared about remembering your entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
So, no. If this is what these guys do, cool. But on the other thing about the Bob thing, so what's going to happen when Bob sells the company?
Well, that'll be different. It won't be personal. I don't know, man. I'm just telling you that a narrative started once he took the 2 years off because he wanted to get out of the contract, right? Right. And I get it. People, well, I wanted to see him because he was one of the top fighters in. Listen, he steered his career exactly the way he wanted to. When he took the time off, they were talking about a possible fight with him and Manny Pacquiao back in those days at Top Rank. Well, it looked like he did it his way, and he's going to get it. And if he would have got that Pacquiao fight 5 years ago, right, how much would he have gotten paid?
A couple million? 2 million?
2, 3, maybe 4 tops, right? That was the going rate to fight Manny Pacquiao and Floyd Mayweather. Their opponents didn't get paid that much money. That's just the truth. Now he fights Manny. What's he going to make? Probably between 10 and 15.
Yeah, 8 figures.
Yeah, 10 to 15, somewhere around there. I think he did it right for him. And, I mean, I'm not the... Oh, sorry, I got a text. Yeah. No, but like... Well, he's been honest with it. He did it his way. So be it. I don't like people milking it as much. But if they're going to be honest with it, then I'm like, oh, fuck it. We already know it. So you can't really get upset at somebody who tells you exactly, doing exactly what they tell you.
And people got to take into consideration, no disrespect to Bob Arum, but the vast majority of Bob Arum fighters didn't get what they wanted. In the last decade, they didn't get the fights they wanted. They didn't get the pay-per-views they wanted. They didn't get the trajectory that they wanted. So you got to think about it. Manny left eventually.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Crawford didn't get nobody really that he really wanted. You know, Mikey decided to leave. You know, Loma, he treated Loma right, but... Loma's fights, even against the people that we talk about, they're under scrutiny. If you remember, the Walters fight, scrutiny. You know what I'm saying? The Rigo fight, not so much but the two weight classes, they wanted to fight, so that's what it was, period. But these are situations where you're getting people on when they have suspect wins and setups on their resume, and it's like, it's not really cool, you know. So, if Bob sells the company, because that was a word a few weeks ago, he's looking to do it. So, you know, that'd be a whole different direction. Then it'd be easy to cross the street, probably. But can I go backwards to the heavyweight fight? If I may,
you never got a chance to talk about it. Yeah, go for it, man.
I told y'all what was going to happen.
Yeah, I told everybody you said it too.
But let me tell y'all what else I saw after the fight. Tyson don't want to hold that crown. I said it a long time ago. He likes getting to the king of the hill. To be the king on that mountaintop. He don't like staying there. I saw it in him. Right when he had the belt in heaven, he was like, yes, yeah. oh, shit. It's me again. Yeah, it's you again. So this idea that, you know, Wilder could probably will probably beat him in the rematch. But let's put that into perspective. He did get beat the first two times, really. Mm-hmm. You know, I understand the draw because of the two knockdowns and the heavyweight thing. I get all that. But as far as he got outclassed in both fights, let's just take that into consideration. The other thing, I just leave Breland alone. He was right. Because Wilder looked shot at that particular mm-hmm. time. He was right. I don't care what you say. I don't care how you feel. I want to be a warrior. I want to die. Breland don't want you to die in the ring. This is not a movie. This is not a Rocky. You got too many kids. So you could be mad at him forever if you want to. But he was right. Fury had a better plan, and he used it. That's just basically what it was. You know? And for all you people who think he's done now, we said the same thing about Joshua, didn't we?
Yeah.
Didn't we? So don't be surprised if he goes back to the drawing board, and all he has to work on is going to the body, throwing a left hook, and being able to handle a tie-up. That's it. That's really it. You know, because that was he can't fight on the inside. You know, that's his major issue. And if you're not going to be able to fight on the inside, you're going to have to be able to handle the tie-up. You know, because you're going to have to tie up if you can't fight on the inside. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't wear you down. You know, I don't want to hear the excuse about the 40-pound thing. You picked that damn costume. Shut up.
Yeah.
Just shut up. You know. You lost. It's okay. Shit. What happened? He was a better man. Take it for what it was.
You know what? The thing is, you could kind of, honestly, think about it. From the first fight, you could kind of see this coming with mm-hmm. Wilder, the excuse making. Because Even though Fury should have got the decision, right? He didn't really harp on it. He's like, ah, they know who won. That's all he says. They know who won. He made no excuses. Like, they know who won. And Wilder, though, was already making excuses. Well, he was really down for too long, and they put the damn stopwatch on how long he was down. And see, he was down for 10.02 seconds, and it was like, it's not 10 seconds, it's a 10 count, you know. Anybody ever count 10 Mississippi? That's not exactly 10 seconds, people. That's just how it works. So you could kind of see this coming a little bit. Wilder was a little shook, and coming after that loss, he's a little shook. We'll see how he recovers. He's invoked the rematch clause, right? That mm-hmm. happened a couple of days ago. It's going to happen in July. That is huge for Tyson Fury, for the exact reason you said. It doesn't give him time to fuck up too much. So it's probably the worst thing for Wilder. If Wilder's smart, he's going to try to figure out how to prolong this thing and give Fury a chance to really fuck this up.
You know, the irony of it is, I was listening to Hot Boxing with Mike and Sugar Ray. And he was talking about Duran, and he's like, I wanted to fight him immediately. Because he said he was like 8 rounds in when he figured out, yeah, I can't fight him like this.
Yeah.
He said, I can't fight. I don't know what I was thinking. I think for Wilder, like, you know how you can't fight him now. So Tyson Fury made all the adjustments in these two fights, just in my opinion. And here's the thing with Wilder. You got to spend your whole camp making adjustments.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because you didn't make adjustments in the first fight. You didn't make adjustments. Ortiz fight, you didn't make adjustments in this fight. Mm-hmm. You're the same exact fighter for all three people. And this is what Fury was banking on. He saw you against Ortiz. That he was banking on. See, you ain't changed yet. You ain't added not one wrinkle. The best thing he ever did as a fighter was in that first fight against Duran when he came in there jabbing. Mm-hmm. That was something completely different. Though he won a title and it wasn't a knockout at the time, that threw a monkey wrench in everybody's, like, wait, he's going behind his jab, like, wait, this ain't we accustomed to. And speaking of the rematch clause, because of this rematch clause, Joshua, you finna get it. You finna get it bad. I'm going to tell you why you finna get it bad. I don't care who wins between Wilder and Fury. I say Wilder wins at Sterling, but you're going to get it bad for this one reason. You were supposed to give Ruiz a rematch. You moved on. So you got your ass whipped in the first fight. More, your ass whipping, you won the title back. But that ass whipping supersedes the way you won the title back. You know what I'm saying? So that's going to put you in target territory.
I will say this, too. If Wilder tries to push that fight back, Fury may drop the belt and go fucking fight Joshua. Because there's a lot of money in that one. Mm-hmm. And we'll see what happens. I want to see the lead-up, because this lead-up made me change my mind. Remember, I even said I've been leading Wilder the whole time until I started seeing the lead-up. I'm like, nah, Fury's got this shit again. You could just see it. Supreme confidence, man. Like, you didn't see that same confidence. You saw more of an act after he beat mm-hmm. Klitschko the first time.
Mm-hmm. I get you.
And he still had it after the first fight with Wilder. If he still has it and they go into the third fight, I may change. I don't know yet. I think, yeah, he could get caught, but let's see. Because, yeah, I don't think he can beat him up again like that.
The best part about all of that stuff, when I was watching, the only thing I kept thinking about the whole time was, Wilder, what he says, I only got to be perfect for 2 seconds. But that's under this assumption. That person is coming to box you. Mm-hmm. See, Ortiz is probably looking at it like, damn it, I could have just kept him on the end. Yeah, you could have. You outboxed him twice mm-hmm. and lost. Fury outboxed him
twice. And won.
Right, and won and then won. So it's, the thing about it is, what Wilder has to actually do is actually do something to that shout out to Kobe Bean Bryant. I forget which UConn basketball star that he was having a conversation with about this. One of the girls' stars, he was like, listen, you got to go back to the championship game and watch it. You got to watch all the mistakes you made so you don't make them again. If Wilder goes back and watches his mistakes, he won't make them again. The question is his pride so sky high that he won't do that? I was in the fight. Yeah, you was there. You was fighting in it, but you were fighting under the assumption that all I got to do is hit him one good time. Because if y'all didn't see this, when the last fight ended, Tyson walked across the ring. He told Wilder, you know, from round one, you got dynamite in that hand. Because if you remember, he hit Fury on the side of the head mm-hmm. with a straight right early in the first round. He didn't go nowhere. So what does that tell you? Tyson Fury, look, I know I gained this weight. I'm doing this new style. I set this whole little thing up. And this is what, for mentally, I'm looking at it like, when they was looking at the other fights and he's cut up and this, that, and the third, I'm like, he's not fighting outside. He's fighting inside. These fights are a prequel to what he's trying to do. Mm-hmm. This isn't, he didn't just fall off the face of the earth. I had to think about it for a minute. I'm like, oh, shit. Wilder not seeing this. Because everybody who fights Wilder fights him on the outside. Nobody fought him on the inside. Nobody made him reach. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, Wilder, if you got the opportunity to win, because Fury don't want to be the king like that. He'd rather be a lineal champ than an actual champ. But he startled me when the speech, your king, I'm your king. Listen.
Yeah.
Listen. Don't let your king in the inside, don't let the pride of that not see why you fail. If you see why you fail, you're going to win easily. But that remains to be seen.
He seems mentally fragile at this point as far as recovering from the loss. He's mentally broken right now. I just see a guy who can't accept it. And people are like, well, what are you supposed to do? Well, hold on now. We've seen other fighters take loss with class. We've seen that, you know. Okay, I know we haven't really got a chance and we really don't have too much time left, but look at Chocolatito when he lost his first time getting like he lost even both times. Like the first one, he won that fucking fight. I'm sorry, yeah, he got knocked down so well. He won that first fight against Rome Fasai. Second one, he gets beat up, but he still gave props. Joshua gave props to Ruiz. Never made any excuses. The only excuse you ever heard was people making excuses for him. Mm-hmm. But you never heard him actually make the excuses. And that's where the Wilder thing kind of was like, people, you know, people are on Wilder. Yeah. Remember when Joshua lost? Wilder was the first one to jump on him. Mm-hmm. You were never a real champ. So guess what? You're going to get it back. That's just how it goes. You dealt it out. You got to take it now. That's just part of it.
The interesting thing about him is, I don't think he think he lost. I think he think the towel got thrown in.
Yeah.
So I'm like, that's why I'm saying you're going to have to get, you're going to have to look at the fight and be like, no, I was getting my ass whipped. Mm-hmm. You know, I had, you know, you got to see that he felt like he has the ability with his power to just to, but the way he was looking, it was like, you can't put it, you don't have enough in the tank to put it together to hurt this man at this particular point. Mm-hmm. You're just going to get your ass whipped. Your equilibrium is off. You look weak. You look drained. You're done. And you know, how the hell you going to get a rematch if you die in the ring?
Yep.
No. No, but speed Chocolatito, because you said he turned back that clock.
Yeah, you know what? We'll hit. You know what we're gonna do? Because there really ain't nothing to talk about this week. There's some fights: Kwanaki and Hellenius, and F.A. Ajogba's on the undercard, and we'll see what happens with them. Ajogba, I want to see some growth because I don't see a future star in Ajogba right now. But we really don't have a lot to talk about next week. We'll pick up and talk about Chocolatito turning back the clock, winning the title. What could be next for him? Is it going to be a rematch with Estrada? Is he going to go Rung Vasai a third time? I don't know if that's the best idea. We'll see what happens. But, you know, shout out to Chocolatito for doing that, for getting the title, beating your fight, knocking him out, just being dominant, being his old self, being dominant. Was it a turn back the clock time? Was it that Duran Barkley thing? Or is this a sign that he's still got a little bit more left in the tank than people thought? We'll see. We'll see going forward. But we'll hit on that more deeply. And you know what we'll do? We'll bust out some pound for pound. We never got our pound for pound list this year. We'll do that our once a year pound for pound list. So we'll cut it off there. Remember, follow the show on Twitter at Cheap Seats Box. iTunes, rate, review, be the next unofficial sponsor. Help us out, people. Y'all been a little lazy. So have we. So just the truth. JP, is there anything else, man?
This is where the fighters fight and the fans commentate.
And we do it just like you from Cheap Seats. We ain't buy no tickets, goddamn it. Peace. I'll never be shamed again. I'll be the next heavyweight champion. Call me crazy, but no one can fake me. I'm the product of the projects. Lost and crazy. Throw your hands up.